I didn't realize my work was as interesting as you made it seem. It's very nice to be back in Hyderabad, and I'm very happy to speak on this subject because it's on everybody's mind. And I won't just speak on fascism because there's no understanding why we are so concerned about fascism today unless we also understand the nature of nationalism and its many guises and the nature of democracy, which is under threat. So I'll speak about the threat of fascism but link it to other doctrines and concepts. Some of this interest in fascism has emerged because both journalists and politicians have claimed that we use the word fascism too easily, that fascism is a phenomenon that occurred in Europe in the 1930s and 40s, and it has a very European context, and to use the word glibly and easily to describe what's going on in India, what's going on in America today, or in many other European nations is to really use an exaggerated rhetoric out of context. And even some of the left has been saying it, making that criticism in India. So there's been a great concern to define, so the challenge when people use the rhetoric of fascism to describe the present government in India or the whole Trump phenomenon in the United States or Erdogan in Turkey is that the criticism is, well, please define fascism. It emerged in a certain context in Europe in the 1930s and 40s, and we want to know why we're using the term to describe things in a very different context. Now, my feeling is that it is absurd to get into semantic quibbles about the term fascism. It's absurd to ask for a definition of a term under pressing political and economic conditions. To put it simply, if there's an elephant in the room, you just know there's an elephant in the room. You don't ask for the definition of an elephant before you decide whether there's an elephant in the room. So I think there is a real sense in which we are perfectly aware that when people talk of fascism, they're describing a phenomenon in which is recognizable. And if you don't recognize it, identify it, diagnose it, analyze it, you can be in a lot of trouble. And in fact, if you look at the trouble that Neville Chamberlain got into prior to the Second World War, it was precisely the refusal to recognize a certain phenomenon. So that's the immediate instinctive response I have when somebody says, please define fascism. I'm perfectly happy to say that we can drop the word fascism and use the word fascistic tendencies. That's fine. There's no reason to insist on the word fascism. And my own view of this is that we can do the scrupulous, conscientious thing and look for a list of similar conditions between Europe in the 30s and 40s of the last century and today, whether it's in India or other parts of Europe or America or Turkey. You can do that, and it's a worthwhile exercise. I'm happy to do it. In fact, in a little while, I'll look at some of those things. But I want to step back before I do that. I want to step back and suggest to you that if we try and look at a larger framework within which these details have relevance, the details about what occurred in the 30s and 40s in Europe and compare them with what's happening now, before we do that, I'd like to present my frameworking thought about how to approach the fact that we are in a condition today, especially in India, more so I believe than in other parts of the world, which approximates fascism. And here's how I've allowed myself to think of it. You see, many of us on the left, most people sitting in this room, have a sense that we have an analysis of capitalism, we have an analysis of the political, cultural fallout of in the modern world of a capitalist political economy, which we've been living with for some centuries now. So we have a framework for thinking of and analyzing the nature of capital and the tendencies of capital. We explain many things by the tendencies of capital. We, for instance, imperialism is necessarily a fallout of capitalism. So the tendencies of capital to create empires and extractively exploit the colonies is something we come to understand only by understanding capitalism. Now, what I'd like to suggest is that fascism is so mysterious to us and so puzzling to us. Even as it is urgent, it is puzzling and mysterious to us because I don't believe that the analytical framework by which we understand the tendencies of capital explain fascism. They are not sufficient to explain fascism. And that is why fascism is so mysterious to us. I'm not suggesting that capitalism doesn't have a role to play in the rise of fascism, it does. But it isn't sufficient to explain it. And that is why fascism is particularly vexing for us. It falls outside of our analytical scope. We cannot take it within our analytical stride because our frameworks don't have an explanation for it. Our frameworks, which have an explanation, are the tendencies of capital. So let me explore this with you for a moment. The first element of fascism that everybody focuses on is its authoritarianism. So this present government, Indian government's authoritarianism we've not witnessed anything like it since the emergency. And in a way it's worse than the emergency because it's created an authoritarian ethos. It's not just a Sarkari authoritarianism, but there's an ethos across the country which the Sarkari authoritarianism has engendered. So it's in a way much more menacing than the emergency, whose menace was relatively focused. The menace here is much more widespread and part of the ethos. So authoritarianism is the immediate, instinctive thing we focus on when we begin to raise the question of fascistic tendency. Now, what is interesting about authoritarianism is to ask the question, why do polities and societies become authoritarian? And a good comparison is to compare liberal democracies, which by definition are not authoritarian, and the fact is that almost every liberal democracy we have known is part of a capitalist economic formation. That is, liberal democracy goes hand in hand with capitalism. Now, the reason why capitalistic democracies are not authoritarian is because of something that Gramsci, the great Italian Marxist theorist, called hegemony. The concept of hegemony in Gramsci's use of the term is an extremely interesting concept. What Gramsci meant by it was a phenomenon by which the ruling class of any polity manages to convince all other classes that the interests of the ruling class are the interests of all other classes. That's what Gramsci meant by hegemony, that the interests of the ruling class convinces all other classes that the interests of the ruling class are the interests of all the other classes. When there is hegemony in this sense of the term, there is no need for authoritarianism, because all the classes accept what the ruling classes want. They consent to all what the ruling classes want. Yeah? So you need to be authoritarian only when there's no hegemony in the Gramscian sense. So that's the source of authoritarianism. Now, if you understand that, then if you ask yourself the question about, say, Modi's government today, you're going to have to come to the conclusion, and it's authoritarianism, you're going to have to come to the conclusion, well, maybe it isn't hegemonic, maybe it doesn't have the consent which it so boastfully and swaggeringly claims to have from all the classes. So it's either that, either it doesn't have the consent of the people, or it has the consent of the people, and its authoritarianism is pathological. Right? Those are the only options. Those are the only options. Right? If Gramsci's analysis is correct, that authoritarianism only arises when hegemony is missing, or only is necessary when hegemony is missing. When hegemony is there, you don't need to be authoritarian. You've got the consent of all the classes for what you want to do, what the ruling class wants to do. So if there is no hegemony, you need authoritarianism. So if you ask why is the Modi government, the present government, authoritarian, you either have to say it doesn't have the consent of the people, which it constantly claims to have, or it has the consent of the people and its authoritarianism is pathological. There's no explanation for it. And I think that this government has, as a result of a craven media, an absolutely craven media in this country, and also because of the vast expenditures by the BJP and Modi on public relations, it has managed to get a kind of agenda. It has a consensus. Even a callous maneuver like demonetization, which has made ordinary people suffer so much, the government seems to have convinced the middle classes that it's an anti-corruption war, complete fraudulent notion, but it has managed to convince them, and it has convinced ordinary, just judging from the fact that there's almost no outcry against it, there's a docility amongst people who've suffered at the hands of demonetization. There's not the lack of widespread protest suggests that in a number of respects this government has the consent of the people. It's come through the creation of a very widespread false consciousness by the media, by public relations, and by generally the weakness of the left. I'll come to that later, but the fact is that it does seem to have it, and so there is prima facie reason to think that the authoritarianism is, as I said, pathological. It cannot be explained by the frameworks we already have, the analysis we already have. Okay, so how shall we then... So that's the first thing to say about it, is that it's not as if it's a mystery. Fascism is not a mysterium. It's actually not even sui generis, but it is a prima facie mystery. We don't have an explanation for it within the terms we routinely use to analyze the phenomena around us. So that's the frameworking point I want to make before getting into details. Now, one of the things to understand about India in particular is that I think we call it fascism because they call it fascism. I mean, Govardhan was openly admiring of Hitler. A number of fascists in the past have openly declared themselves to be admirers of what happened in Germany in the 1930s, and Hitler. So it isn't as if we are doing something which is sort of tarnishing people with a brush. They have actually thought of themselves as boasted about their allegiance to these things. So it can hardly be. It becomes an arcane academic objection to say it's fascism, to deny that it's fascism when the people have consistently done so. And I think India is worse than any other part of the world today because there is no equivalent in any other part of the world of the fact that this party and this government is supported by a long-standing paramilitary fascist ideological organization. Donald Trump has no such organization. Nobody in Europe has such an organization. So just the simple fact that there is an umbilical link between the BJP and the RSS makes the Indian situation quite different from the former so-called populism that is said to be quasi-fascist and so on in other parts of the world in the last year or two. So that's the first thing to say about it, that the very fact of the RSS as an underlying generative organization, cultural, political, paramilitary, it's just unique to India. I mean, amongst the populisms that have been identified in the last year or two. The second element, I think, that's very important is the great desire to describe anybody who opposes you as committing treason. That is a very deep aspect of fascism. In fact, the reason why many people call the McCarthyite era fascist in the United States, whether it was or not is another matter, is precisely because I didn't know, maybe you can give examples in the discussion, but I don't know of any other government which has said of its own people that their behavior is anti-Indian or anti. Only America in the 1950s said behavior was anti-American. And it's happening now. And Kanhaiya Kumar is called anti-Indian or anti-American. So far as I know, no other country does. I mean, think of it. Do you think it would make sense to think that somebody sitting in the Danish government would say of somebody who criticizes the Danish government that they're anti-Denmark? It's an absurd idea. It's a comical idea. No other country does it except our country now. And what made the McCarthyite period so vexed a time for America was that it was another occasion when it was widely done. So that's another, I think, very important part of a very different kind of authoritarianism, is that any opposition gets granted as anti-national. So if I were to say, which I do say, that the Indian army has behaved with fascistic tendencies, has been absolutely the most disgraceful form of violence has occurred in the valley in Kashmir by the Indian army. If you say that openly, you're counted as anti-national, anti-Indian. So, but
by the way, I'm saying it now. And the idea that somebody might suggest that there might be a redrawing of political arrangements so that a whole region has more autonomy and so on, is the idea that that should count as anti-national is a self-contradiction, because you have created new states of the union in this country constantly over the years of independence. You have done it. The government has done it. So why can't we talk openly about the possibility of autonomy and the creation why is it anti-national? Just because you have an occupying army there, it becomes anti-national. So there is an absolutely clear sense in which the use of the term anti-national is done with a very specific purpose, to establish the total authority of a government to declare something which may contradict its own governmental policies over the whole independence period of redrawing states of the union. But on this particular issue of Kashmir, we're not allowed to speak about it without committing treason. So that's another very important part of it. The third is, central to it is, you should ask yourself what the history of Europe was, and why it is that Germany in the 1930s and 1940s was the apotheosis of something that was always a part of Europe. You see, the great thing about Gandhi and Nehru, who may have made many mistakes, but what Gandhi and Nehru did claim was that we do not want to generate, this I'm talking about the freedom movement, we do not want nationalism that is European. You see, Gandhi is constantly criticized for being an anti-modernist, an anti-European, anti-West. But just think of what Europe was and what he was reacting to. What happened in Europe? I think the last time I spoke somewhere else in Hyderabad a year or two ago, I was raising this point. The history of Europe is something that is papered over, and what happened in the 1930s and 40s is treated as a very exceptional thing. It's not exceptional. It's just the apotheosis of something that was there for centuries. And this is how it started. In Europe, in the 17th century was a watershed in Europe. It was the beginning of what is called early modernity. And when Gandhi criticized modernity and Europe, this is one of the things he had deeply in mind, I mean centrally in mind. And that is that in Europe, for the first time, people began to look for a justification of state power. What gave legitimacy to the state? Because for centuries before the 17th century, people just assumed that a state was legitimated by the divine right of the monarch who personified the state. So that was just taken for granted. The state is justified because of the divine right of the monarch who was personifying the state. Now, in the 17th century, such theological justifications of the state began to be questioned with the rise of science and the development of what is known as modernism or humanism. So new forms of justification of the state were needed. And the new form turned away from theology, because that was no longer what was easily something you could turn to with the rise of modern science. So they turned to political psychology to justify state power. What do I mean by psychology? Well, the idea was to create a feeling in the population for not the state, but a new form of entity which was emerging in the 17th century after the Westphalian Peace, which was the nation. And the nation was undecoupably joined with the idea of a state. That is, for the first time in the 17th century, the nation and the state became fused and were expressed with a hyphen in between them. It was a nation-state for the first time. And this political psychology of justifying the state, which is the right-hand side of the hyphenated conjunction, was to create a feeling in the population for the left-hand side of the hyphenated disjunction, the nation. And because they were completely fused as a single entity, the nation-state, for the first time in the 17th century, a feeling by the populace for the nation created the justification for the state. Now, later this came to be called nationalism, but this was the process by which European nations emerged after the Westphalian Peace in the 17th century, by creating a centralized, power was extremely scattered for centuries, but it began to be centralized with the creation of this entity called the nation, and its justification came through this psychology of creating a feeling for the nation with which it was fused. Now, how was this done in Europe? Everywhere in Europe, it was done by creating this feeling for the nation was generated by creating an external enemy within the territory, despising it, subjugating it, saying the nation is ours, not theirs. The Jews, the Irish, the Protestants in Catholic countries, the Catholics in Protestant countries. This is Europe. That's Europe. Savarkar came centuries later. This is Europe. Right from the mid-17th century onwards. The history of Europe is the history of nation building by finding an external enemy within and subjugating it. And Savarkar was a European. Gandhi and Nehru did not want this nationalism. They said, we have never had this nationalism in India. The discovery of India by Nehru is constantly talking about how there was an unselfconscious pluralism, there was no subjugation. So the point is, it's Europe in which the germ of what happened in the 30s and 40s in its extreme form was there for centuries before. Fascism is often defined by finding an external enemy within and subjugating it and despising it and subjugating it with violence, which was what happened in the 30s and 40s, but it had happened for centuries before. Now, when it happened in the 30s and 40s, it happened through the idea of it's ours, not theirs, happened through notions of tradition, purity, Aryan origins, all of which are central to the notion of Hindutva. Vedic purity, Aryan origins, and so on. And so race, blood, and things like that became much more central to how it was done in the 90s and 30s and 40s. And that added a particular veneer to a history that is, as I was describing, finding an external enemy within. And that veneer is replicated by much of the rhetoric of the RSS and of Vedic purity, and going back to Golden Age, whether it existed or not is another question, and a purity of race and origins and so on. So that too is a very strong element of... I won't go on about this, because there's a whole lot of other things one could say to make the comparisons with Europe, but I think you get a sense that all of this gives one a very instinctive sense that there is an elephant in the room, and you don't have to do more than start preparing yourself to defend yourself against it. All right, so let me then just step aside a little bit from these comparisons and ask, not talk not just about India, but talk about this phenomenon today, and also to ask, how is it that we have come to use the term populism, which is a term which is constantly applied to Trump, it's applied to the sources of what gave rise to Brexit. It's what many of the right-wing politicians in Marine Le Pen in France, for example, is described as populist. Nigel Farage in the UK. All of these movements and phenomena, how is it that we have turned to using the word populist as a term of opprobrium, as a pejorative term? Because populism in its dictionary usage means opposition to elites by the people. How can that be a bad thing? How can it be a bad thing to oppose the elites, for the people, ordinary people, to oppose the elites? How did the term come to have a bad meaning or a bad complexion? Well, if you look at the phenomenon, so let's take Brexit for a moment. Now, or take Europe, the idea of a European Union, which is suddenly something that ordinary people are recoiling from, are reacting against. That's described as populism. By all the Europeanist ideologues, it's described as populism. So, what is going on? Why is it happening? Well, imagine you're a working class person. Let's say you are a working class person in the Thames Estuary, or in Nottingham, or in Madrid, or Seville, or Athens, or Crete, or something. You might ask yourself today, why would I, a laborer, either working or workless person in Spain and Britain and Greece, almost 50% of the youth is unemployed. So either a working or workless person might ask the question, why would I ever want to be part of a supranational union? Why? My future depends on the government providing some safety nets for the working people. Housing, education, health, basic income, food. Which supranational site has ever dispensed that? The only site at which safety nets and welfare has ever been dispensed is the site of the nation. I don't even know how to begin to think of a welfare mechanism dispensed by the European Union, by some supranational side. What would it be? What would it look like? It has never been dispensed. Welfare has never been dispensed by on any other side but the side of the nation. So why would a working person in these parts of Europe ever want to be part of a supranational union? Why? What could possibly motivate? Now, such a person might go on to say, and I don't want these outsiders here. I've had a long, glorious history, and I don't want these outsiders. They're taking away my jobs. They're ruining our national culture, which goes back centuries and so on. They might also say that. So, they might say, two sets of things. A working person might say, why would I want a supranational union when everything in my life depends on institutions that are done by the nation state? Why would I want a supranational union? A very shrewd, very insightful question. Then you say, xenophobic things. And these guys who come into my country are just taking away my jobs, ruining my national culture, etc. They might also say that. Now, I think populism, in the good sense of the word, asks the first question. And as soon as it irrationally links the importance of the first question with the second question, it becomes populism in the bad sense. So there is a good populism and there is a bad populism. And what is really important to understand is that the good populism, is genuinely and rightfully opposed to an entire political establishment. Not just the extreme right. The extreme right has in fact generated bad populism, we all know that. But the point is that the entire political establishment of Europe and America are responsible for people asking the first good question. Why should I join the union? Another way of putting the point is that if you take America now, you see, I want to, it should go without saying that Trump is much worse than Hillary Clinton. But if it should go without saying, then I don't want to say it. Then you shouldn't say it. Because if you say it, you give the impression that there's something intrinsically good about Hillary Clinton. But there isn't. The political establishment and the Clintons are the monarchs of the political establishment. They own the political establishment, much more than the Republicans do. It's the Clintons, Bill Clinton, who created the financial crisis. The financial crisis emerged in the period of Bill Clinton, policies that he established. I mean, if you look at the history of both Britain and America, the greatest achievement of Reagan and Thatcher was, from the point of view of the right wing, the greatest achievement of Reagan and Thatcher was not that it generated right wing policies, but that it created Blair and Clinton. That was the greatest achievement of Reagan and Thatcher. They created Blair and Clinton. They destroyed the Democratic Party and they destroyed the Labour Party. They took the Labour Party away from Labour. They took the Democratic Party from decades of commitment to social democracy, ever since Roosevelt. That's the achievement of Reagan and Thatcher. So in my view, conservatism, right-wing are easy targets. I mean, you know, this is not the right time to say this, but I'm in front of an audience in which I can say it. I wouldn't say it in America, but I think the real enemy is liberalism. And we should not be afraid to say it. Conservatism is an easy target. It's a dangerous thing. I'm not saying that it's more urgent. It's very urgent to oppose conservatism, but the real deepest enemy is liberalism, because it's an intellectual challenge to oppose liberalism. Liberalism comes with a facade of a moral high ground. It's all this talk of liberty and equality and so on. They've got great ideals, liberty and equality. It's a very curious thing that you can't seem to be pursuing liberty without undermining equality. The whole history of Europe and America is the pursuit of liberty at the expense of equality. So all of this makes liberalism really the hardest and most important challenge to oppose for the left, I think. And as a result, I think that of course it's right to say Trump is worse than Clinton, but it should go without saying. If you say it, you give the impression that liberalism is, that Clinton's liberalism is somehow got intrinsic merit. But Clinton's liberalism and Obama's liberalism are the sources of what has made working people miserable in their conditions in both Britain and America and Europe. So there is a political establishment which consists of both the Democrats and the Labour Party in America and Britain, as well as the Republicans and Tory Party, and it's the, all of it is the political establishment. See, in America, India is different because in India there's a multi-party system. In America, because there's a two-party system, if there's a consensus between the two parties, then everybody's left out in the cold. And there is a consensus between those two parties. We are lucky to have a multi-party system. So we can make, within parliamentary politics, we can hope to make allowances. Even if there is, so on the economic front, there's a complete consensus between, throughout the last 12, before this government got elected, there was no disagreement of any serious kind between the BJP and the Congress on political economy. It's the same view. Basically, since 1990, they held the same view, 1991. So, but we have other parties which could put pressure. I mean, you wouldn't have had the food scheme and the employment scheme if the left hadn't put pressure on the first UPA government. So you have possibilities of alliances, and it seems to me really shocking that the left can take a stand of this purity that you can't make alliances with other parties, you know, secular left parties, and it just seems to me shocking. No one party is going to oppose this government successfully. It will have to be through a united front of alliances of secular left parties, and it is absolutely unrealistic and shocking to think that you can remain aloof and from these alliances and oppose the present government. So the general point about populism that I'm making is that ordinary people in Europe have asked the question, working people have asked the question, what do I gain from a European Union? And they say, working people gain nothing. It's a banking elite, the fallout of which is a relatively well-off upper middle class, which created the union. It's a perfectly well-functioning common market. It was erected into a Eurozone. Not that Britain is part of the common currency, but there are many policies that come from Europe, and ordinary people, working people, don't want it. That's a shrewd, insightful understanding of the situation. And then they say further things which are not things you can infer from the sensible things they ask. The xenophobia and so on. And that constitutes what we recoil from in populism. And one last thing to say about that is, you can't blame the people for that. You see, you can't blame the people for being xenophobic or racist. There is a widespread tendency in the West to, when something bad happens, to say, well, the people are vile and stupid. Right. And they're racist. The point is, it's the people who have this xenophobia and so on are shaped by an enormous range of influences that shape their thinking and their mind, not just education, but what they read in the media and what their political class tells them. You can't forget that when Obama, the Democrat, was campaigning in 2008, his position on immigration was much worse than McCain's. He wanted to take the immigration platform away from McCain, from the Republicans, and he said much worse things about immigration. Not as bad as Trump, but much worse things about immigration than McCain did. And if Obama can say it, how can you blame the people for being xenophobic, for being populist in the bad sense? If the political class is preaching it, not to say nothing of the tabloid media and the Fox News and so on, if their whole minds are being shaped by this, including by a politician like Obama, why do you blame the people for coming to this view? Cameron, when he wanted to take the platform away from Farage and the UKIP party, made immigration a big issue in his campaign. So the political establishment was doing it, not the extreme right. And if the political establishment does it, that shapes the mind of the population. So you can't blame the population for the bad populism. Because in a democracy, you can't blame the electorate. You can't believe in democracy and say the electorate is stupid or vile. How can you believe in democracy and say that? If Rama Melkote told me that the electorate is vile and stupid, and I believed in democracy, I wouldn't accept it. Now, Winston Churchill says that democracy is bad, all governments are bad, but democracy is also very bad, but better than the others. But why? Why is it better than the others? If you think that the people are vile and stupid, and I thought Rema Melkite was a person of great judgment, I would make her the queen. Why would I believe in democracy? Why? I mean, if I thought that she had judgment and the people were vile and stupid, why would I believe in democracy? I'd make her the monarch. So you can't believe in democracy and say that the people are, the electorate is unredeemable. So you've got to look for reasons why they are, and really the reasons come from how their knowledges are shaped by the political class and the media and so on. You know, philosophers for 2,000 years have said that the main question in ethics is, what ought you to do? But in our modern complex time, the question, the more important question is, what ought you to know? It's the prior question. What ought you to do cannot be something you answer unless you have asked a prior question, what ought you to know? And in our time, in our complex time, there's an enormous wide range of things you know, and it's constantly contaminated by the media, which has a lot to answer for, and our classrooms, and our political class. So all of this wide range of things, if you believe in democracy, you cannot blame the people. The orthodoxies that give rise to populism are the things to diagnose. Everybody today, there's a hysteria about Trump's election. Not just in the United States, all over. You open a newspaper, you open the Independent, you know, on the first page, 6 out of 10 of the columns are about Trump. Everybody's obsessed with Trump, they're wringing their hands about Trump, and nobody really is asking, nobody in the political establishment is asking, how did he get elected? Why did he get elected? What does it mean? And if you ask that question and you retain your belief in democracy, you have to really criticize a whole range of institutions and the political class and the political establishment in these parts of the world. And in the end, I think, capitalism cannot explain, our analysis of capitalism cannot by itself explain it. The links between capital and these bad populist and fascistic tendencies require much deeper analysis, and we are only beginning with this task. Thank you.